So without further ado, let's have a big round of applause and we'll get started. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you, Lynette. Okay, so tonight we're going to go ahead and start this whole... Well, first off, thank you all for showing up for this event. This is awesome. We want to start this event off with the actual trailer itself, and then we'll move into explaining the processes and everything in the project. So without any further ado... Sound issue?
Did you, have to shut the sound?
Yeah, the sound is up. Okay, try it again.
Miss, when have you thought about it? Come on, man.
Every once in a while, a revolutionary idea comes along. One that breaks the mold of convention. I give to you the chariot of the United 4000. A race from San Francisco to New York in 12 hours. It is the fastest race the world has ever seen.
Feels like you're being pushed down a path you don't want to go.
I beat you in endurance, strength, and speed. You're expired.
Look back and you're so far away from where you once were.
Stop it.
From what mattered most.
Dad?
Charlie.
What the hell are you doing here?
You try to take my daughter down with you, it is not going to happen.
A little late to play daddy, you know?
You find out it's not a race, Ethan. Life's made up of moments.
Hey! What the hell are you doing?
Get this loser! Let's go!
And you gotta fight for every single one.
You could die out there.
So this project actually started, I would say, like over 5 years ago while...
Yeah, back in 2011 while we were still in college.
Right,
we played around with the idea, all three of us.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, we've always wanted to collaborate and do a project together. And one of the reasons why we decided on film was, you know, because we're all like fans of movies and all that kind of stuff. And we wanted to do something that's very unique, future-oriented, and we all love, like, vehicles. Like, I love things automotive, and...
Yeah, we love tech within film and experiencing something that isn't necessarily real within the sci-fi genre.
Yeah, so one of the things that we thought was interesting was, like, we, you know, growing up, you were always, you know, told that, you know, in the future there's going to be flying cars, and that's one of the things that, you know, we just never saw. So we thought, like, it'd be cool to be able to bring the idea of flying cars, you know, to life, to make it real, really look at the science of it, and see if we can, do something that's, like, you know, very cinematic and interesting with it.
So with that, we'd like to start tonight out with what the vehicles look like. This is what the final interpretation of the vehicles are, but we had many ideations throughout the time as we were developing the project. So when we first initially started this project, Peggy Chung, Mark Yang, and myself started to put together mood boards based around the type of design premise we were looking for. We had this concept that the vehicles were meant to be sort of revolutionary. It was the first time hover vehicles had existed within this world. And so they were like the early types of F1 vehicles. Extremely experimental, a lot can go wrong with them.
If you look at the references, like, we were looking for something. I mean, I think the easy way to do it would just be if you did an F1 vehicle and made it fly. And, you know, I think that the classic idea of what the flying car is just a flying brick made of glass soaring through the air. And I think we wanted to try something that's relatively believable in our world, but at the same time a projection of where it can be. And it's kind of shown in some of the references, maybe some of the things that are possible, and maybe some of the things that, that could happen.
Can we go from there?
Yeah, and so you can see, this is just one page of many of, like, all the ideations we went. It's totally blue sky. We all just, like, went for it. There wasn't any specific direction yet.
Yeah, we were just messing around at this point. And we had a lot of friends helping us early on in the project, too. Joseph Martinez, if you're here in the audience. There you are, buddy.
Yeah.
some of these sketches are his on the left here. I believe this bottom one is Peggy's, and on the far right is Mark's. And these were just some of our initial sketches all of us started to work on together.
And one of the things we learned early on was just not to edit our ideas. I mean, as artists, I'm sure you guys understand, like, anytime you put down something, you want to redraw and make sure it's perfect. And we just wanted to be exposed to as many ideas of what it can be as possible before we actually decided.
And as we were developing this idea, we wound up going with one of our teachers from our college, Joe Ryder, who works at JPL. He wound up helping us develop the base concept of how these things could actually float and the power source that we need for these things. So that way we actually had a premise to go off of for the entire body for the vehicle.
Yeah, I mean, just the idea that it rests on a magnetic field and that it required emitters was something that was really interesting to us. I mean, I think what you see a lot in terms of maglev vehicles, especially now, is you need a track for that kind of vehicle to move. And what we wanted was something more akin to, like, you know, the Baja races where, you know, the action could be everywhere and it's not necessarily restricted to a track. So we explored ideas of having emitters and setting up a magnetic field that all the vehicles could rest on. So you can, like, go from point A to point B and not be restricted by the movement of just a single track.
Mm-hmm. So our emphasis was really not having, like, a set track, but just a field for the racers to go across.
Mm-hmm. And then with that said, we started to create these emitters. Some of them made their way into the film at the end of the day, but these emitters would be placed throughout the United States, and they would create a gravity field for these vehicles to float across as they would go through these areas. They don't need an actual track. It would just create miles worth of field for these things to float on.
The initial idea was that it would slingshot you the closer it gets to an emitter and propel you to the next point. I mean, if you were to do this realistically, I guess you would have to have the emitters pretty close, but since we were doing a short film, we had the emitter spaced somewhat far apart so we can incorporate more scenery into our shots.
And again, this was all super blue sky, so we were just going crazy and seeing what we could develop. So these were some of the early versions of the vehicle we started to do once we got a lot of the design premise or the technical reference from Joe. And we started to actually play with pads and things like that would rest on the vehicles in the place of their wheels.
Mm-hmm. And the main thing out of all of these is that there's a cabin for the racer to be in, the pads, and then, like, turbine in the back.
Right. I mean, so one of the main things that we wanted to do is make sure, that the vehicle can... the thing about races that's fun is they crash, right? The cars crash, cars explode, and we really wanted to create, a capsule that you could really recognize the character in, because when the thing's going by 200 miles per hour, that's the only thing you could see representing the main characters.
And this is just more renditions based on that, like showing a central pod and then pads that stick out from them, and we just kept ideating until we got to something that started to fill a little more comfortable between the three of us. Mm-hmm. And then we started to break down our own design language a little bit more and see what it was that we liked in the forms that we were creating and also in reference that we were gathering on cars that we really loved and stuff that even Joseph did himself. And then from there, Mark actually did this initial illustration out of all the concepts we were doing. And this really solidified us in the world because it gave us a sense of scale, what it would actually feel like to be in this world if you were down in the streets or something like this as these vehicles flew over you. And again, this is just blue sky, so we're just generating ideas.
Yeah, I mean, we had done a lot of paintings we had done a lot of paintings before this, just kind of showcasing, the cars passing each other, but this was really good in terms of, like, showing people that you know, it can be a race where, you know, people can just be walking about, you know, on their, you know, on their daily walk and look up and see the races pass by ahead of them. And that was something that was told to us that was somewhat different. And so this was when I, this was kind of what propelled, you know, the idea of momentum and what took us in that direction.
And again, going off of what we had talked about earlier, which is having like a capsule, the turbine, and then you see these emitters, and we really kept with keeping four, so it kind of moves like an animal, and that was kind of a huge part of this whole design brief along the way.
We're all extremely OCD, so we just kept building 3D assets, things like that, in order to explore where the parts could sit if this thing was real overall. And then finally, we wound up solidifying on something like this, which is we have the four emitters spread across the body, a really rough design for the roll cage, and then a central area for the pilot to sit. And the reason why all these look like skeletons of a vehicle is our whole design premise was to design the base cage for all these guys, and then you can just design shells on top of them afterwards.
Right, and you know, another one of the reasons why we went so rudimentary in terms of like where the vehicle design came from is it kind of led us into deciding to make a short film about the creation of these vehicles, and I think for us to really know where they come from, I feel like lend a little more credit to, you know, this guy that's actually making a flying car.
And this was the final thing we generated out of all the different sketches we were doing. And to give you a little idea of what we were doing at this project, we started doing it right out of college. And we did it during entire summer that we were out of school. And we were working off and on. When we got around to this final design that we really liked, we actually all wound up getting jobs right. At that point, and the project just stopped entirely.
And then that was when you went off and
To Ender's Game, and that was a huge eye-opener to me when I got onto that project, because I got to see not only design like sets and pieces like that for it, but I also got to see them build the actual sets that we designed for the project. And that was a huge learning curve for myself, because I got to see the different types of structures and woods and things like that they were using, which then led me to believe that I could create my own project,
right.
Which is crazy.
Yeah.
Anyways.
No, and that was, and during that time when you went off to do movies, like I went off to, I got hired by Disney Imagineering, so we started working on different theme parks, and that was when I kind of got really into the idea of just, you know, like how vehicles work and really like the experience that you would experience inside a vehicle that's going like, you know, through a story element I was able to bring some of that experience back.
And then at that time, I had left to go work on Pacific Rim, and I was able to see, again, like the process of the filmmaking from the concept to final. So it's a lot of fun to see that.
So with all that said, we left this project for about 8 months. And then when we all kind of finished up on what we were doing job-wise, we came back, and we all really remembered that we liked doing our own thing. We really wanted to explore our own ideas, and we thought it was best to continue with momentum because we had created so much great content for it for ourselves.
And, you know, like, after doing work for other people, we just wanted to make a movie of our own.
Yeah.
You know, so I thought
So with that said, we then rolled into pre-production 8 months later. We started to build a team. See, all these are off for some reason. One second.
Yeah.
Ta-da! Okay. So when we came back to this project, we had some great ideas for our vehicles at this point, but we didn't know much of our world. So that was really our big challenge for ourselves, as we started generating mood boards. And a lot of these Peggy actually created herself. I'll let you explain it.
Yeah, I mean, so I went through and thought about mood boards and like the feel of like a character, you know, like assigning an animal to it, like the person that, you know, they are, the things they wear, the job that they may have. And so you can see in these various shots, it's like, oh, okay, this is our antagonist, and you see like, you know, like a hyena, and then, you know, bring in like a rock star, you know, at the bottom racer, possible actors that can fill the role. And same for Charlie, the daughter character, she's like this badass and, you know, but it's a very vulnerable character as well.
And I like mood boards, and we use them a lot for work even now, because they kind of encapsulate almost like a whole like act of a movie, right? I feel like they're kind of a nice like movie poster type thing that comes across and is able to communicate your vision to a lot of people. At the same time, they're very quick, and you can edit your ideas very quickly.
Yeah, this way we don't have to spend a lot of time just concepting. We can just generate an overall feel for the character just based off these boards. We instantly know who they are. Mm-hmm. You know, for instance, with this character, his name's Grizzly, but we based him off of a bear and his attitude and how he would be in the film.
Yeah. So once we got settled on the mood boards and we all agreed, you know, to go a certain direction, then we started working on different storyboards.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like storyboards are kind of the visual Bible for the movie. So
Let me pull this up. So after we generated all those ideas, we started to come up with a story premise for the entire project. And we hired a good friend of mine, Sabrina, who works at Disney doing on Gravity Falls and other projects doing storyboards. She helped us generate all the characters for this animatic. Oh, sound is off again.
Since when have you thought about it? Come on, man.
Every once in a while, a revolutionary idea comes along. One that breaks the mold of convention. A gift to the chariot of the United 4000. A race from San Francisco to New York in 12 hours. It is the fastest race the world has ever seen.
Feels like you're being pushed down a path you don't want to go.
I beat you in endurance, strength, and speed. You're expired.
Look back and you're so far away from where you once were.
Stop it.
From what mattered most.
Dad?
Charlie.
What the hell are you doing here?
You try to take my daughter down with you, it is not going to happen.
A little late to play dead, man.
You find out it's not a race, Ethan. Life's made up of moments.
Hey! What the hell are you doing?
Get this loser! Let's go!
And you gotta fight for every single one.
You could die out there.
So we generated this in order to create sort of an overall
spine.
Yeah, spine for the project. So we knew what we were doing the entire time. Mm-hmm. Let's see.
So once we knew the animatic, what it could be, then we started getting into the concept art and like fleshing out the world. So for example, this is like San Francisco, future San Francisco. What if it's like a little bit more like Venice?
Right, and the reason why it looks like Venice is because, like, in our proposed feature, you know, a giant earthquake actually broke up a lot of the land in San Francisco and turned a lot of it into waterways. And that actually segments to why we need flying cars, because infrastructure was getting to a point where that is so expensive to rebuild that someone just was like, well, you know, it's not that expensive to do flying cars. Why don't we give it a shot? And to prove his concept, he decided to have a race from San Francisco to New York in 24 hours, and that's where the whole story started.
Which generated, the United 4000, which is what this story takes place in. And like the Baja 1000, that race was generated by Honda originally to show off their motorcycles, that their motorcycles could make it across the Baja in a couple of days without dying, but it was grueling on the drivers. And so this project was running with that same theme, that a new vehicle was invented, but is extremely experimental and dangerous for the drivers. So this image was also setting up some more mood for our world. This is deep within San Francisco, and so we really wanted to play with like atmospheric cloud weather, things like that, but also how tall structures have gotten within the cities. And those were our main characters in the alley as well. And then this leads us into the vehicle being unveiled for the first time by Constantine.
Yeah, and Constantine is the guy who decided, who found the technology to be able to build cheap cars. And this is when he was unveiling it to, you know, all the people in the auto industry still making traditional cars. And a lot of them were in disbelief of this race and didn't think that they can go anywhere.
And so this is our overall map. This is what the drivers are supposed to run through in about 12 hours. 12 hours is supposed to be what the overall race takes place in, but you're supposed to finish it faster than that overall. So that's supposed to really show off the speed of these vehicles and the different types of terrains they're going through. They can't fly like a jet. They still have to stay somewhat close to the ground. Mm-hmm. So there's lots of terrains they have to go over with their magnetic systems,
right,
like rally vehicles.
Right. And for our short film, we only covered essentially up to New Mexico.
Yeah.
And, kind of goes through the drama of the main character trying to, you know, cope and really, like, get used to the fact that he's, you know, like a flying car is not exactly a car, not exactly a plane, but somewhere in the middle.
Yeah.
So this is one of the first fittings that I did for San Francisco, the starting line, and so this is kind of giving off the mood and the feel of the place.
And we still wanted to go with a race theme for the entire project, so not everything was designed. The idea is they're still using, like, rock and roll trusses and things like that for the setup of the race as they're getting ready to go.
Yeah, and this one's like an iteration that Mark did on top of his initial painting that we were all inspired off of, and just taking the vehicles that we designed and then also elaborating more on the emitters.
And this is an explosion painting I did.
it's the New Mexico leg of the race, right?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So this was supposed to hit on a key point within our story and our script, which is as the drivers are racing across, certain emitters pass over each other as the drivers are trying to drive dirty or pass each other in certain ways, and things just go wrong as they're in the middle of the race, since these things are so experimental. Mm-hmm. And the idea is that the project itself is not a death race, but it just inherently is dangerous with the way these things are built. And so this was the final design we came across with our vehicle. The 3D model was built by Mark Yang and myself. Mm-hmm. We finally landed on this skeleton.
Right.
And then after that, we started generating the different shells.
Right.
And the reason why we went with one skeleton is we could only really build one model with a
limited budget as well.
With a limited budget. We can only build one model with a limited budget, and we also went with different skins on top of it.
But if you look at also a lot of, like, rally cars as well, you know, the undershell of what consists of...
They're all the same.
It's really not that different. It's really, you know, the fairings that they add to it and the sponsorship logos and all that.
And so the vehicle keeps splitting. What we did is we generated different shells for these guys, and then we would also mix-mash the shells through all the different background vehicles. That way we'd have them racing along with the main vehicle.
Right, and we've had a lot of talented automotive designers actually help us with some of these drawings. One of them is working for not Tesla, but the other company,
Hobbin?
Faraday.
Yeah,
I mean, we're working for Faraday.
Yeah, I'll go back to this one, but this is Hobbin and Joseph's initial ideations, and this really sold the look of them being almost kind of like Le Mans cars in some ways, too, with their paint jobs and their skin aesthetic, but on this rally-like chassis.
Yeah, I mean, like, what we're able to do is get friends that, you know, do transportation design as a day job. It's, like, really helped us flesh this out to be really automotive.
Yeah, and that really shows, like, what a team effort this project was, because we learned a lot from our transportation friends.
Yeah.
So after we came up with the base design for the vehicle, we then really got into what's the orthographics of this thing so we can build it out.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'm sorry, go for it.
Yeah, I mean, a big part of it was figuring out what do we actually build, what actually is built in 3D. So at this point, we're going through the building of the chassis, then Mark and Robert went through the orthographics, especially for, you know, for 3D, and for logistical things for us ourselves.
And we could have jumped straight into building this thing in 3D, but Mark and I, since we were doing this in tandem with each other, we both really needed to know what each other was doing. There were so many little parts to build for this vehicle. So we did these orthographics off the bat, so that way we both had an understanding of what we were going for. So then after we did those, Peggy and I went to a junkyard and just found a ton of different pieces to start building this cockpit for the vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
And then me and my nephew actually started to build the underframe for our cockpit. So these are all the development photos showing the different pieces we used, the platform we built, all the PVC pipes we used. So the whole pipe structure you see around the vehicle is all PVC pipes. We used caulking on all of our edges to make it look as if it was welded. And then we sprayed the entire thing with automotive car paint without putting a finish on top of it, which gave it sort of a metal finish at the end of the day.
Yeah, and a big part of this was kind of like one giant kit bash. We're just like, okay, we know we need to fill this area with stuff. So we take all the parts and kind of like,
that doesn't work.
No, that works. Yeah. This thing is extremely heavy, by the way.
Yes, it is.
So we got to the point where we built out the whole shell, painted it over, and it was the point of like taking the graphics and like, hey, what do we stick the graphics on here? So I took these two pictures and then took Mark's graphics and just slapped them on in Photoshop.
And this was just us experimenting initially.
Yeah. I feel like being able to put corporate graphics that kind of puts you in that world, it makes the, you know, it really does make like whatever you're driving a little more believable, you know, because. When you just have like a cool spaceship without any kind of like history and function, it's hard to really care that
yeah,
much
you,
about.
Yeah, you were really trying to think it through as if it was a real product. So we have a lot of like industrial type stickers that go all across the entire shell. And this was the final cockpit at the end of the day that was used. So as you can tell, we didn't have the entire thing built out. We just had the part that the actors actually interacted with. Everything else was CG'd. Around the actors. So after we built that initial cockpit, we then did a second orthographic breakdown of the actual build itself.
Yeah.
And then we had to rebuild it in 3D as a supplement model in all of our faraway shots for the vehicle.
Right. And it didn't need to be that detailed because at that point, most of it was inside the actual cockpit shell.
Yeah.
So
with this, we have a little video to show you.
Me, Peggy, and Michael here at a junkyard today.
I'm trying to figure out how to get this awesome piece off.
Well, we just got all the parts for our vehicle.
We're out here cleaning all the parts we just bought in the junkyard. Peggy's giving us a nice wash. We're soaking some pieces. And over here you can see the pieces drying. Turning out quite beautiful.
I mean, the really cool thing is like being able to, you know, kind of mimic what real metal looks like, but it's not really real metal. You're using PVC pipe and painting over it. But the fun part is that in camera, it looks like metal.
Yeah, I mean, large scale model making is just, it's so cool. Especially if you could just bash parts into it.
Yeah. You can get away with a lot.
And then after we built that, we really had to start tackling all of our other props in the film, like our helmets, things like that. Yeah. So as you see on the table in front of us, these were our final helmet designs.
Right. And these are the initial drawings that Peggy did to explore the helmet and the costumes, right?
Yeah, I mean, the big part of it for us was that we needed to see the actor's face. So being a clear visor was always like number one for this design.
Yeah, and then we started doing like explorations of suits and things like that, and eventually we came across these suit designs and the helmet that Peggy did, and we really felt good about these suits because we wanted to have this is something we were able to do at the end of the day, like we talked about.
Right.
But the suits themselves were supposed to project sponsorships, things like that, across them before they get into the vehicles. And then once they're in their vehicles, they just turn off and you're in the race. But we never had time to explore the actors walking around outside the vehicles and things like that.
Mm-hmm. I mean, ideally we wanted it to be like billboards like shining across them and like words going across. But again, it was like a budget reason and so.
Timing wise.
Yeah. And then from the point of doing that sketch, we had a talented artist come on, Alex Leakin. And so his job was to build the helmets out. So what we did was like, hey, this is generally the design. Like, take it, do sketches, make it yours, and make it understandable for you to build.
Yeah. In the beginning, we considered building it from scratch, but, you know, we came up with, like, certain restrictions, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just, it's pretty tough because, again, like, logistically, having building a helmet from scratch was a ton of work, and being able to get it to fit on the actor's head. Again, we didn't even know who the actor was yet, so rather get, you know, a lacrosse helmet and build on top of that. And the funny thing is, like, this lacrosse helmet had to find some guy in some random forum, like a lacrosse forum, to buy it from, because they were, like, they're only made for 500 of them.
Well, this one's a special prototype helmet. That's why it's clear overall, but our initial concept was that way, too.
Yeah.
So we wanted initially wanted to do a clear helmet, right? And the only thing that that was out there that you can find was the lacrosse helmet.
It's the closest we can get, so.
Yeah. And then these are just more developments of it being sculpted, and then once we got it finished sculpted, we started casting the pieces, attaching them to the helmet. This was a group effort, so everybody was doing this thing. This is me living with Bondo.
A lot of Bondo.
And then eventually, once we got good surfacing, we wound up doing the final paint job, and then Peggy and Mark both worked on the decals for these guys.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, we were able to cover the helmets with the same decals as the vehicle to give it a sense of sponsorship and, you know, the fact that it all came from kind of the same racing culture.
Yeah.
The funny thing about these helmets, again, like, similar to the vehicle, it was like kit bashing things. So, for example, if you go back one, you see like these little triangular pieces here. It was like one of the things I sketched early on, and then we got to this point where we're like, do we mill it? What do we do? And so we thought about it, and we're like, oh yeah, like Pepto-Bismol bottles, just chop off the bottom and then cut through it and add extra
and
little
put
pieces.
A little filter on the inside of it.
Like a 3M mask filter.
So use what's around you.
Yeah.
And then after we were able to get a lot of the art assets together and also the concept art together, we were able to kind of, you know, put together a visual Bible for how everything's supposed to look like. And at that point, that was when we approached Michael to help direct us. Because before this, we, you know, we were all artists and working in the field, but we didn't have that much experience actually filming, doing like a short film. So, you know, at that point we thought, you know, like it was good to collaborate and meet people outside of our field that actually, you know, went out and shot a lot of stuff.
Yeah, and to really to teach us more overall on the project. Okay, and so these were the development cycles of the helmets. Yeah, that was it for the helmets. Moving from there, I think that was it for production. Mm-hmm. It happened again.
So the next part of it was funding. So we got into Kickstarter for that. The big part of it was that, you know, like, we didn't expect to fund the whole project through Kickstarter. It ended up being like 1/4 of the project.
And honestly, it was actually, it wasn't even our main thought at first. We didn't know we were going to do a Kickstarter. As we were going through with the project, we realized it was something we really needed to do.
Yeah, I mean, at that point, we had been working with pre-production just to kind of get all the assets together. So at that point, we had met up with someone, our producer, Anna Halberg, was able to kind of help us organize and kind of kick things off. And, you know, one of the things that that the Kickstarter really helped us do was to have transitional funding from the planning phase to the actual filming phase. And like Peggy said, it was essentially only 1/4 of what we ended up using. But, you know, I think for us to have a Kickstarter was really important because it was a good way to kind of get the word out on our project to get people up to date in terms of like where we are. And there were a lot of people supporting us. And I think for us, one of the things that we learned about having a successful Kickstarter is always to kind of keep the people that are supporting you in the loop. So like really prep the people who...
I mean, that was a really big part of this is when we were prepping the Kickstarter, we initially reached out to family and friends right off the bat and just saw if they could help us at all. Mm-hmm. And that's the easy part of all this because families and friends can only help you so much on the project. And so we then had to turn to online and just start reaching out to people online and seeing if they were interested in the project and what we were doing.
Yeah,
I mean, that's kind of a big thing. Like, if you're interested in doing a Kickstarter, it's like a huge responsibility. It's definitely not a small feat, like all the preparation and also keeping everybody up to date about what's going on. And, you know, even after your Kickstarter's done, it's also keep people up to date as well. So I definitely would say, like, if you were interested in doing a Kickstarter, like, you start prepping, like, months before.
It's also its own production.
Yeah.
Like
it's a beast.
Once we launched our Kickstarter, we spent every day for a month solidly promoting the Kickstarter.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Going to different websites, asking if they would post it, and then people tell us yes or no.
Yeah.
And we did all this on our own cause, too. There was no one helping us with this project. We were just pushing for it.
Yeah, and the thing with the Kickstarter campaign, too, I mean, like, be willing to try different things. I mean, we had something in mind that we thought was totally going to work, and then we did, you know, we filmed it. We kind of showed it to a lot of people, and, you know, we didn't actually go with our first idea. We went with our second idea.
Yeah.
So I think another thing that's key about having a successful Kickstarter is also to go to people who have had it, you know, succeed. And I think every Kickstarter is kind of unique in its own way. If you have a product-based Kickstarter, that's different than, you know, like a film-based Kickstarter and other things as well.
Yeah.
And we made our funds. Woo!
Yeah.
I mean, we're super thankful for everybody that contributed, who shared our Kickstarter with other people. It's definitely a really cool experience. And
it was really amazing to see all of our friends come together, and just it was almost overwhelming seeing the support that we got from everybody at the end of the day. Then thank you, Kickstarter, for helping us push through the project.
Yeah.
Let's see.
So we jump into the BBTS.
Yeah, so with this one, we'll go ahead and jump right into the BTS footage. So this is all the BTS from us on the set days as we were building and shooting. So with that, a lot of the set stuff you see, everything pretty much we had to set design in production design.
Yeah, I mean, initially we had a production designer that we were working with to who was very experienced, and she had to hop off the project because something came up. And at that point, you know, I mean, one of the things that we had to learn for ourselves was that, you know, you just have to use whatever talents you have at that point and really jump into something, even if you're not unfamiliar with. And at that point, I had never production designed before.
Not gross.
Yeah, but, you know, we kind of got everything together. We asked for as much advice as we can, and we just went through and together production designed the rest of the movie.
So this was the final look of the garage scene that we have in the trailer. So at our college, there was this old Mel
post office
that was next to it. And they were in the middle, our school bought it, and they were in the middle remodeling and turning it into something new. They were completely demolishing it. So we asked if we could film in it. They said yes.
Yeah, and what was funny was, like, you see the debris that's back there. When we actually moved in, there was four times the debris in that actual garage. So we had to find creative solutions to actually, you know, manage it and make it look cool.
And so these were, like, rough concepts we did based off of the actual room. So this is the pano that we had of the space. And then we did a rough concept in a day or so on top of this, just showing what the space looks like. And then we did a breakdown so that all of us were on the same page as to what we needed to do when we got in there. Because we only had a day to really do all this before we started shooting.
Right. And we wanted to also design a space that we could shoot 360, right?
Yes.
All the way around.
Yeah. And so after doing all this, this is what the final space looked like at the end of the day. We really wanted to sell that the space was larger than what you actually see, and so we used drapes to indicate that there were parts of the vehicles being built in the background and things like that. A lot of the stuff you see, like the pad sitting in the background there, was actually like a giant piece of foam core that we cut out, and we just put it there to give us a nice silhouette. As if they were building stuff.
Yeah, a lot of it was kind of like cheating things for, like, you know, the camera in camera, so, you know, it's okay to push things back. And again, like, the tarp is to cover up certain areas because they didn't let us, the school didn't let us move certain things in the back, so we're like, okay, all right, we've got to, like, figure this out. So tarp was our friend.
But it actually, in a lot of ways, works better because, I mean, being able to kind of shadow certain things in and having those garbage parts there kind of made it more realistic because at this point of the story, the main character actually was kicked out of the state-of-the-art training center and had to move into a garage that was a little more run down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and some of the backstory, too, of this garage, as to the people who helped us, Kyle Spiker, who is our VFX soup, he did an incredible job on the project. He really guided us, especially in this scene, as to the tracking markers and the HDRs and everything that we needed in this space in order to get the realistic look that we had with the vehicles.
And this is our talented DP, Will Myers.
Yeah, and so, like, for the space, like, all of us had to design it to be a 360 space for Will to be able to walk around and get whatever shots he needed without any, like, any limits.
Yeah. And then, of course, the monitors on the walls, we had to CG all those in.
Mm-hmm. Right. And that's where Kyle, the VFX soup, was, you know, very useful in really determining what we had to be careful for and what we, you know, what we were,
Able be able to supplement information for post.
And then moving on to our digital shots, this is everything related to the cockpit shots themselves. So everything was green screen. You know, we built the cockpit, but we shot everything on green screen. We had different lighting setups for different times of the day, depending on where the vehicles were supposed to be at in the United States as they were screaming across. Mm-hmm. We also made the vehicle interchangeable. So if you notice, like, his shoe is popping through there. All the panels pop off of the vehicle. That way we could get the camera really close in on certain shots. Mm-hmm. Like, we have one shot where it's like an extreme angle and you see him making a sharp turn inside the vehicle.
And a lot of this is like us talking with the DP early on, like, hey, you know, we have this, like, the cockpit, and he would come around with his, like, 5D and walk around the cockpit and be like, oh, you know what, I want a shot here, how about here and here? And we're like, okay, so we had to design accordingly for that.
Yeah, I mean, you have to remember too, it's not about you when you're doing this project. You have to consult with everybody as you're moving forward because they're the ones that make the project amazing at the end of the day. They really will drive it. You can only provide so much.
Yeah. I mean, as an artist, that was the first time I was on a green screen shoot. And I think I've come to realize, like, how important it is to have an efficient film crew because if you don't make your day, then it's another day of incurred cost of props, the actors, and everything else, and it just gets much longer.
Yeah.
And then this scene in particular, this is when they're sitting at the start line getting ready to go. So we had these giant lights that were going from green, yellow, red, And so as the actors were sitting there, we'd go click, 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 and they would go through all the different colors, and we have those colors on them in those shots.
Yeah, and like we knew that needed to happen because of the animatics, all supplementing back to what needs to be shot on set. And being very clear with the DP too, and he's able to set all that up for us.
Yeah. And then moving on to some of our other side shots too, like the car accident scene,
right.
Which is supposed to be our main character Ethan's wife passing away early on in his life, and that's what changed a lot of his views on the world.
Right. And going back to that earlier shot with the accident,
this one here?
Yeah, this part. I mean, like how that was set up was they had a sliding rig with. With lights attached.
Yeah, we had two like fog lights that were attached to a rail system that were setting up in the air, and then as the car was supposed to approach, the lights would swing down towards the window, and that way it looked like lights were coming at you in the scene. And then we just wrote those out, and then we put the digital truck in the scene.
Yeah, and that was one thing that was communicated to us very early, that whatever VFX we're supposed to have, it always have to be... backed up by proper lighting and motion and
practical lights.
Yeah.
Because if not, you're trying to do it in post, it's always kind of like dodgy.
It just never works.
And we had awesome, like, bloody makeup job by our artist, Victoria.
Who's in the back right corner there.
She's always ready with the blood.
Yep.
And in this scene, so the window's cracked, but actually it was done in post. And it was something that we had talked about with our VFX soup was, like, should we do this practically? Should we just have, like, a broken, you know, piece of glass and put it on the car, which it was a possibility. But at the end of the day, we were just like, you know what? Let's drop some trackers on there and then just do the crack in post.
And this is just an overall example, too, of what the bar scene looked like that we have. We only have one photo from that day, but this was actually our first shooting day on the entire project.
Yeah, and rule of thumb, the first shooting day is usually the most chaotic because it happened to be raining. It happened to be a place where no parking was allowed anywhere. So
Downtown LA.
We actually had to make our assistants like circle the trucks because it was just...
We had to keep moving all of our background people's cars all day because we couldn't keep them parked for more than 2 hours.
Right, and the area that we arranged for actual parking didn't allow us to park
That was my welcoming to film.
Yeah, and like this was like the biggest shooting day too. There was like 60 people cast and crew total. There was rain. There was parking situation in like downtown LA. And
right.
So,
and I mean, the thing was, it was an amazing bar, even though it was very small. But it had a acrobatic
aerialist.
Yeah, an aerialist dancer that came down from a chandelier. So we wanted to make sure that it was very professional and that you know that we can actually get the shot done in a very confined space. So it was stressful.
Okay, let's move on.
Yep.
This is production.
So getting into post-production, which actually was like the biggest chunk of the project itself.
Yeah, I mean, leading up to the actual filming itself, we spent probably a half a year from, it about a half a year?
Yeah, like prepping to shoot.
Yeah.
I mean, thanks to like our producer, Anna, we were able to truncate a lot of the process because she's very experienced and we were able to get a lot of what we needed down. Yeah, it was easily within half a year.
Yeah, exactly.
And the filming itself was only like
a week.
Right?
It was about a week of shooting.
Yeah.
But then when we got done with that, we're like, oh, cool, yeah, we can finish VFX in like 6 months or something, right?
Yeah.
No, 3 years later.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of this was, you know, a big part of it is like we were all working for years, like in evenings and weekends.
I mean, that's the thing about the Kickstarter. You can only ask for so much, especially for a film on Kickstarter.
Yeah.
You really have to cover a lot of it yourself. So when we got around to the VFX process, that all came out of us in order to make that happen for the project. The Kickstarter really helped us with getting the shoot ready and moving forward with that, but everything VFX we had to do. So I will give you guys a taste of our VFX breakdown.
Thank you.
So that's that chunk. I mean, so for this part of it, we worked with many like artists across the world, as well as a company called Goma, which is with Doza. He's actually from Gnomon as well, and of course several other people from Gnomon as well.
But if you look at the video, I mean, obviously everyone had a lot of fun, but you know, this right here is the reality of what
like, this is all of our VFX breakdowns right here.
Anyone who has done VFX understands it's all about shop breakdowns and how to get them done and how much it costs and
This ended up being like 170 VFX shots.
We were ambitious for our first project.
We're like, oh yeah, no, it's fine, it's fine. And so it went from like 170 to like 70 at the end of the day. And so this looks like it's super fun, but this was like a really small chunk where we went around and got like HDRIs just for the post-production.
We basically took a trip for like, what, 3 days like that? And we were just driving all the way up to Zion, and we were just taking photos and HDRs as to where, like, where the vehicles would be going in 120-degree weather, which you see up there in the top right-hand corner. And then this is where
reality
hits. So we were pulling basically geometry from Google of those locations that we went to, and then reprojecting our HDRs back onto the geometry that was pulled in those areas.
So a lot of this information is like, again, like supplemental information for the environment like modeling team. And yeah, a lot of it looked like this.
Right.
Yeah, the first time I saw this stuff, I didn't know what I was looking at.
No.
It just took me a little while to wrap my head around it.
I forgot how much we went through.
And that was the thing, too. I wasn't a VFX artist when we started this project. I was purely a concept artist. So I had been learning throughout this entire process. And now I can stand in VFX quite a bit more. But before, it was just sort of like running, just start running.
So a lot of what we do is, like, because the VFX, you know, we learned a lot from, like, the VFX side of things, right? Like, you know, you send something off, VFX team has to make up for so much more. Like, what's the backside of this? How does this look like? How does this effect look like? So what we did was we, you know, put on our concept designer hats, and we're just like, okay, we'll give you, like, as much information as we can. So we spent, like, every night, you know, sketching things out, pulling more information in, reference in.
Yeah.
Just for the team to see.
I mean, for 3 years, we spent almost every weekend, at least I did, just like creating detail notes and stuff for all the CG artists to run off of.
Yeah. Right, and you show them, and then you know you go through the cycle of whether they can or cannot do it, and sometimes you have to go back to the drawing board and do what can be done.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, the perfect example is right in this shot. We were supposed to do a stadium where they show off actually the Maggie for the first time, and that was something that we wanted to do, and we actually even modeled the stadium and you know, took all the references that were necessary, but at the end of the day, it was just too difficult.
Our friend Harnick and Andrew both modeled the crap out of the space, and the model was incredible, but with what our budget was, we couldn't pull off at least looking good the people in the space, and so we wound up with going with something that we could pull off for the shot that also looked amazing. And so this, oh, I'm sorry, you want to go for it?
Yeah. I mean, so again, like, in the VFX stage, the modelers, you know, we gave them this model, and then they had to clean it up, like, retopologize it. Then it got to the point where they're like, wait, how does this joint work? How does this one area work? So, you know, Robert dived in, did some screenshots, and then did little paint overs of what it could be modeled out as.
Like, even though Mark and I modeled this thing, You only know so much while you're in the middle of modeling. As you start to move into post-production, start to move things around, you're like, hey, this thing doesn't move over here. What are you guys thinking about that? So Mark and I would just spend weekends just going in there and like doing doodles and stuff like that and sending it back to the team, and they would refine those pieces and make everything flex and work correctly.
Mm-hmm.
And then this is more animation notes. So after we built this thing, like Mark and I know how it works, but no one else on the team understood that.
Right. I mean, we essentially had to have like draw additional storyboards to see how the thing actually functions in Flex. Because I mean, a model you can demonstrate some functionality, but at the end of the day, like if you want it to look like you the way it should look like in the film, then you got to bore it out, you know?
Yeah, and we really wanted these things to have life and move like animals, so we really put a lot of focus on the arms, on how they pull and turn, and the magnets, how they flap, and everything like that.
Yeah, and those were all just, more boards, more drawings.
Yeah. okay, vehicle turntable. Let's see.
So with all that information sent, given over to the VFX team, this is what we ended up with. Two models, two shells out of I was like 12 shells.
Yeah,
that's
quite a bit. I mean, a lot of the background ones are a little simpler looking because we don't put a lot of focus on those.
Yeah.
But the green one you see was modeled by our friend Diego, who's also from Gnomon.
Mm-hmm.
He's helping us currently on a new project.
Very talented.
Yeah, he's very talented.
Segueing into motion graphics, again, we had to give information over for VFX on how this could work. So, you know, first thing that we usually go through is, like, figuring out the function. Like, we need, you know, a headset, being able to have, like, integrated, like, heating circuits so it doesn't fog up the glass. You know, what's their HUD look like? So taking inspiration from aviation, that's what we ended up with on the right, the little blue box. And so that's what I kind of designed out and handed it over to them.
And this is sort of an example, too, of, like, we did so many of these, like, little concept art blips to show, like, okay, this is the two scenes we have. This is them merged into the scene with our 3D assets. And then here's a paint over to show what that would look like. But we wound up cutting the shot at the end of the day because this was, again, a part of the original 170 shots that we had. And so we had to pick and choose which shots we thought we could tell the story with in order to finish this in a decent amount of time.
Right, and that's the other sexy thing is you have logistics and VFX meetings, and you determine the hierarchy of shots that you need to build the film versus just, you know,
gotta kill some of your babies.
And, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so this is a really detailed breakdown. I do tons of these, even on our projects today.
Yeah, we have a lot of those.
Let's see. But basically, these were the initial animations that were done on the left for our crash sequence at the end of the film. And I just wasn't happy with the angles that we had and the perspective and how it was kicking and stuff like that and how it spun out.
And you can describe the movement to death. At the end of the day, you just got to go in there and position model yourself and show them.
Yeah, so I wound up doing tons of notes, like you see on the right here, that are just showing like the angle we want, exactly how it kicks up, how it spins. And I just get really detailed about these things because I see it a certain way. And then I give it back to the team, and they give me something even better back in the day. And that's what it is. Like, you're constantly kicking back and forth with everybody in the team.
Yeah, and then, like, again, going all the way down to the end, we have boards on the final title sequence that we worked with Kyle and Tashi. And so just showing like what it could look like, and they totally cracked it out. It's just like what it should be.
Okay, this is the funny thing too with our end title sequence, and actually with shots throughout all of Momentum. There's lots of dirt being kicked up by our vehicles as they're flying around. That dirt was not particles. That dirt was real dirt that was being thrown at our camera. Peggy and I one day just went into the backyard. We couldn't find good footage anywhere online. So we wound up just taking a bunch of dirt. We just put Saran wrap all around our camera and just started chucking dirt at that thing left and right in order to get the right amount of throw that we wanted.
It worked really well, but when I saw you guys looked like you came out of an explosion.
We were just covered in dirt.
Yeah.
And this is sort of our final breakdown, too, for the Maggie's textures. And because everything in this project is meant to be in the year, like, 2040, even down to our materials, we wanted everything to be new. So we're playing with the idea of buckyball texture or buckyball material. And there's not really a texture out there for it. And so we came with our own little honeycomb pattern that infinitely keeps getting smaller in honeycombs. But as you see, like, on the right here, this is a reference photo, it almost becomes like a snake skin. And so that was something we really, really wanted to see on the Maggie, especially when you get like light shifting across the surface in those shots.
I think the VFX team worked, did like five times.
Yeah, they did like five different passes
like
or
like different
more.
Shininess into the matte.
And then something that I feel is very important is our color story that we have throughout the entire film. And so we borrowed a lot of stuff from other films. And the way I worked with this is I'd pick shots I liked from films, and then I would play with the color and saturation within those shots. So like this shot doesn't match the shot exactly in Gone Baby Gone. Is that this film? I think so. But I basically increased the saturation. I played with the colors a little bit, and then I wound up doing color dabs out of it and picking the scenes that would have those colors for our amazing colorist Tashi to go off of. I wound up, you know, we wound up picking some Sid Mead paintings for like what the bar sequence would look like, and then same thing with like rally dirt vehicles. And we picked some really good stuff for that, and then we wound up upping the saturation. Mm-hmm. I'm just not a big fan of really gray films. So that was something I really wanted to focus on, was like a strong color story throughout the entire project. And I believe that's it.
Yeah. Thank you, guys. Finish line. Finish line.
Okay. Oh, wait.
That's okay.
Yeah. That's fine. I mean, do you guys want to roll into... This is just going to be up here up top. So you want to go into Q&A?
Yeah.
Lynn.
Thank you so much, guys. That was amazing. Do we have any questions here in the audience?
Hi, guys. I have two questions. Yeah. I believe I must have missed it, but you said that Kickstarter funded a quarter of the whole thing. Mm-hmm. Where did you get the other budget from?
We saved our pennies.
We worked.
Yeah.
I mean, essentially, I think the short film was somewhere north of 50K, and we made about 20K through the Kickstarter. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, I mean, so, you know, we didn't get to quit our day jobs. We, you know, work our normal jobs, put money aside, and then, you know, like, supplement it to VFX or any other parts of the project.
Yeah, I mean, I think when you're doing something like Kickstarter, you just have to be realistic about what you can get out of it, especially for a film project. And I think as long as you are and you budget that, you know, accordingly, then that's kind of where you probably have to shoot for. So. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. The other one is you all three are concept artists, right?
Yes.
Mainly. Is there anything that you found through this project that you want to specialize on next to concept art?
Well, I mean, like, creation and directing. I mean, it's kind of like the fun part of all, like, bringing people together and creating, like, more projects. This is kind of like our bread and butter. I love.
Yeah, that was something we really wanted to focus on, is, like, even before we went into college, all three of us really explored a lot of our own stories and ideas. And I think once we got into the working world, we lost that side of things. We were always catering over to somebody else. And I'm totally okay with that. But at the same time, we have a lot of our own ideas and projects that we really want to explore. And this is sort of the first foundation for us to get into something and bring our ideas to life.
Yeah. I mean, I think for me, like, I always wanted to do my own project. But in terms of specializing, you know, like... Like, I was, you know, it made me love vehicles even more. And, you know, that kind of, like, you know, flows into what I'm doing now for work, which is doing vehicle design for movies. So. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Next question is here.
Hi, Mark. Hey, good evening. I'm just curious about when, at what point you guys were, especially, like, when you built that cockpit out of all the supplies, at that point, was that... already the Kickstarter started? Did you guys pull out of the Kickstarter fund to build that cockpit, or was that completely out of your guys' fund?
Go for it.
Also, just at that point, I'm curious about how far along you are with the story. Did you have the whole storyboard script? Everything's done. You guys are super confident in the story, and so you're just like, go for it, all in. We're going to build this cockpit and start and just go for it. Or were you still kind of... in between and still kind of figuring out the story?
At that point, when we started to build the cockpit, we already actually had our animatic, and we had a rough foundation for the story that we were running with. And so there were certain assets that we could go ahead and start moving along with that we knew weren't going to change, like the cockpit and stuff like that. Hmm. For the project. As for cost, that actually came out of our own pockets to build the cockpit. And the cockpit itself was roughly about $4,000. to build that with all the materials and even the junkyard parts at the end of the day.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah. Where was that junkyard? Was it in LA?
Did you just? I think it was in Corona where we went.
Very good. Yeah.
It looks so much fun. I want to do that.
Hi. How much of the trailer will be in the final product, and how much of the final, like, will the final product be like a full feature-length film or a short-ish film? This is the first time I've been exposed to this Please. Kickstarter.
Right.
No. Yeah, you want to go for it?
Yeah, I mean, I think for any movie pitch, I mean, usually you have some sort of sizzle reel, right? I mean, so we shot way over the target, mainly because we want to learn more about filmmaking and, you know, and prop building and the whole process of, you know, actually being on set and shooting the film. Because we were, before this, we were just artists, you know, in our drawing along. So I would say that if there was actually a feature film and it actually got made into a project, very little of our footage would actually really make it into into it. They would actually have another budget, and they would film everything differently. If you look at some of the projects that have gone, they rarely use the prototype for what ended up being the actual thing.
And going off of that, too, what a lot of people do is if they have a story they've already created, they'll create a sizzle reel. And usually usually what you do is you rip things from other projects, and you'll create an assembly of that, and you'll pitch that around to different people. For us, there wasn't a lot that we could rip from for a hover car film, except for like maybe pod racing, things like that, but we really had a certain idea as to how things we wanted them to look. And so we spent a lot of time on just designing those things. We really wanted to see them come to life in our own project.
And usually the people that you're pitching to have their own ideas in terms of where the project can go as well. So it generally looks a little different than what you submit.
Yeah, I mean, like, at the end of the day, if this was made into a feature film, it could look entirely different than what we, like, wanted to do. So, like, end of the day, like, this is what we want it to look like, and it's kind of cool we can walk away with this.
Yeah. So that's why we thought it's important to have a strong vision, so if it ever gets changed or added to, there's a piece of us, you know, still remaining in it.
Mm-hmm. Because they funded for this aesthetic, this design, so they can't change it that much or
else. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. I see. Yeah. That's really smart.
Thanks.
Okay, next question's here.
Hi, thanks for coming out. Appreciate a lot.
Thank you.
Maybe I missed it, but what school did you guys go to, and do you have any tips for life immediately after school, and what did that look like for you? Thank you.
Okay.
So we went to Art Center College of Design for entertainment design up till 2012, 2013.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the biggest tip I have for you too is just don't stop learning, especially if you want to create your own projects, like coming out of school. Because for us, we jumped straight into working, but at the same time, there was a part of us that we felt like we couldn't create anymore with our own projects. We were devoting all of our time to work. In a weird way, that was kind of suffocating. So we all wound up coming together to learn new ways of doing things and learn story and learn all this. That way we could generate those ideas that we've always had while we were in school.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I definitely would promote, like, you know, get a job, but then also in your night and time that you have on the side, keep your passion project going because, you know, that's what keeps us going. So,
I mean, I think work, sometimes you can do some really interesting things and you can learn, but at the same time, it does compartmentalize you because it is about efficiency. So I think it's always important to find people around you that like the things that you like and collaborate, and, you know, if they're not insufferable, then you could create something fun.
Yeah, I mean, and the last thing I would say off of that is that, you know, when you work a lot, you kind of lose your own taste. It kind of gets washed away, and you're like, wait, what do I like again? So, like, doing personal projects allowed us to keep, you know, like, oh, yeah, that's what we like. We want to keep supplementing this. So,
yeah.
You actually mentioned that there are quite a few Gnomon people have helped you with this project. Like, how did you find them? Like, what were you looking for in them?
Lots of emails. we blasted a lot of people, just, you know, sending out emails, and we were very upfront with a lot of people. We could pay very small amounts for what we were doing for this project at the time, and so we let everybody know what we were doing, and we told them, please say no to us if you don't agree with what we're asking you. But we wound up reaching out to Diego Gonzalez, and also Doza Kim, who owned his own studio, Goma, that we wound up working with in order to generate a lot of this stuff at the end of the day. Because, again, we emailed a lot of people and worked a lot of people all across the world. So they would all create their own assets here and there. And we did this for a long time, but we needed a way of putting everything together. And so Doza really helped us with that by taking all the assets using his studio and putting it all together as one package.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, a large part of it was like VFX producing, like because we weren't personally VFX artists. We just basically were like, what do you need? Like more compositors? Okay, we look, search, find like compositor. What else do you need? Texture? Okay, we'll find another guy. Like we're just like, whatever you needed, we would supplement that.
Right.
And the big part was I just went on the Gnomon website and I was just like, oh man, these guys have like great work. So, I mean, yeah, student gallery.
And a lot of people did tell us no. So.
Yeah. That's totally understandable.
But another really practical way of being able to hook up with people is to kind of trade expertise. You know, there are people that want a concept art and we needed expertise in certain aspects of movies. And everyone has projects that they want to pitch. Everyone has different passions. So when you help other people, they will help you.
Exactly. We would do a lot of extra work for people that were helping us on this project. So that way they had art on their side if they wanted to go pitch with something. So it was a lot of it was trade, too, that we did with a lot of other artists.
Yeah.
That's great. We just have a question here. Is that right?
Hey, guys. Really good stuff. In hindsight, is there anything that you would have done differently looking back at all this? And then moving forward, is there anything that you would... is there different ways you would solve the same problems you did on this project?
I think I would have just made a sizzle reel without the VFX. the VFX was...
It's crazy.
Was, yeah.
I mean, I'm glad we did this because it was a huge learning curve for us at the end of the day. Like, I know so much more about the VFX process than I ever knew.
Right.
But kind of like finishing this and talking to a lot of people in the industry, they were just kind of like, yeah, you don't really need to do that. We're like, oh.
Like, if you wanted a learning process, then this is great. But if you just want to pitch something... I would not go this far.
Yeah, I mean, for us too, for Peggy and I, since we both own Gadget-Bot together, this was also sort of a staple for our company. Like, we really wanted to show people what we could create with our own ideas and stuff like that.
Right.
So that was one of the reasons why we did pursue this. If I had to do things differently, I probably would have started the VFX process before we started filming.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I was told that early on, and I didn't listen. And now, after we finished the filming side of it, I was like, oh, 3 years later, all right, we finished the CG, woo!
Yeah, I mean, like, we learned a lot from it. Like, me and Robert directed a new film that was not out yet, but we planned it like crazy this time around because we know exactly the things, the snags that you can run into, which is always VFX.
And that was the problem with this project, too, is we didn't have a lot of the assets we need. Like, we didn't have HDRs for every scene. We didn't have stuff like that, and we just didn't know that at the time. And now, like, with our new project, we have everything and more some than we would need for it. And it's really been helping us, like, up the quality bar on the new project.
Yeah, I mean, like, if we had to do it again, you make it, like, shorter. You make it, like, a minute
long.
Yeah,
make it
more tangible. Yeah. So that's a way to do it.
Yeah.
Cool, thanks.
Thanks.
So kind of going off of that, during the production, was it the three of you as, like the three-headed dragon, right? Like, you all, like, synchronize and have the same input? Or was it more, not hierarchical, but, like, did one of you have more say? And if so, or if not, could you guys share maybe a story of dissension between the three of you, like, on a certain topic, a design, or anything like that, that may be informative to the process?
I don't think the three of us ever had major issues.
I mean,
we went through college together, so we had a lot of time then, especially when we had work on the walls and stuff like that, to critique each other, and you get a lot of the harshness out of the way then. So like once we got around to this project, we kind of had a natural flow with each other. There's definitely things we didn't agree on, but nothing that turned into a fight or anything like that. We would all sit and kind of weigh it and go, okay, would that help the project? Would that hurt the project?
Yeah, I mean, like, and even got to the point where you're asking, like, hierarchy. There wasn't really hierarchy. We just split things up sometimes. So, like, for example, like, on the production, when we got to this set, like, I couldn't be there that day because we were doing costume, like trying on the costume with other actors. So, like, I went off with the producer and the actors to try on their outfits while Robert and Mark were on set like cleaning and like sticking the stickers down, and
so dirty.
It was just such a tight time frame that we had that, you know, we just split it up and we trusted each other because, you know, it's been like months of like prepping, or like we know what we like just go.
Yeah.
So I mean, I guess knowing each other well.
Mm. Yeah.
All right.
Hello.
Hi.
My question is really on how do you guys figure out when your final shots are all complete? Is it just when money runs dry, or is there a scene you gave yourself like a deadline? How do you know when it was done?
We gave ourselves multiple deadlines.
Yeah, we had a lot of deadlines. I mean, in terms of planning the initial shots, even when we were doing the animatic, we were pretty crystal in terms of how many shots we want. And if you even look at our shot list, it's actually pretty liberal. We had quite a few. In terms of if you're talking about the post-production phase, that absolutely is when the money ran dry. And at that point, you just have to plan towards like, well, how much does every shot cost, and get reliable information, which is not always easy to get from the firm that you're working with. But if you can, then you do have, you'll know way ahead of time when you're going to run out of money at that point.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of it, like, we did have to set a deadline for ourselves because we got to the point where we're like, we need to get this done. You can't just refine forever, but, like, you're driving the VFX team crazy. And then, like, us, like, after work every day, like, heading over to the VFX studio till, like, 10, 11 at night, it's just, like, it's pretty grueling. So,
initially, what was pitched to us by the director was that the movie can't be 15 minutes long. But when we really looked at the actual cost breakdown and how much work relating to how that would work out, then you realize sometimes unattainable.
You can only afford a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, like, we just gave ourselves a hard deadline. We're like, we have to make it. And I think we were about a month out. It was, like, a month over, and that was about it.
Yeah.
At that point.
Yeah. And that comes down to also knowing the partners that you're working with, whether or not they'd be okay with that. We did argue about, whether or not, we wanted to limit our scope in that way. But if you're working with people that you understand, you can come to an agreement.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we have a question that's come in on Twitter from Voyager FX. They're asking, are you using cloud rendering for animation, and do you have any recommendations for managing the rendering process for VFX shots and sequences?
Well, we didn't use any cloud rendering on this.
No.
It was just the studio within themselves. They had their own server, and they were able to crack that out.
Yeah, we were able to link all their PCs together, and we were able to crank out some of these renders in like an hour or something like that too. And we get quick feedback and check out things, and that's the advantage of working with the studio, is you get really quick turnaround. The problem with cloud renders is it gets really expensive really fast, especially when you're testing. Now what we're doing with our own studio, Gadget-Bot, we have a couple of PCs that we all have linked together. And that's sort of our own mini render farm that we have in the studio, and that lets us test some of our like really big shots in. And then once we okay something and we like it, we then send it off to a render farm and kick out the final render that way. If it's a really big scene. If it's small, we can do it ourselves.
Yeah, you just, like a lot of the shots, they would just let it run over the weekend, and then we just saw it on Monday.
Yeah.
So.
Hey, another question. I'm not sure if I picked it up, but did you guys actually get your pitch through to a studio to make it a feature? There was a mention of Paramount, so...
No, I mean, like, I work for Paramount Pictures, working on Transformers, and right now I'm actually working with Legendary for Pacific Rim, but in terms of pitching to a studio, no studios has picked it up yet, but then the way it works is you partner up with people who partner up with other people. So right now we are talking to a couple of producers about, also partnering up with other people, but it's always a process.
It's a slow go a lot of the time. A lot of the people you hear that have their project bought right away after you see it come online, they actually already have an agent or someone they've been working with in the background, and then by the time they finish the project, they already have the contacts to send it to, for the most part, and to see if people are interested in it.
Right, and sometimes that's an in-studio pitch as well.
Yeah.
Right. So if you're coming from the outside, it usually takes a little bit, and that's where we are.
Yeah, and we're entirely a pirate crew. Like, we just did this because we could.
Good job. Thank you.
Thanks.
I saw online when you announced the Kickstarter project, some people were calling it Fast and Furious with flying vehicles. How did you feel about that? Were you flattered? Or?
No, that's cool. I mean, I love racing movies, so, Fast and Furious has really good action, and I know people that work on it, and they deliver pretty good products, so...
I
wouldn't consider that.
I don't think it's bad at all. I think it's really cool.
Yeah, that's fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. Any more questions?
No.
Goodies.
There's a lot of blood in these helmets.
Good evening. Regarding the technologies for this car to hover or fly, were these imaginary technologies, or did you reach out to engineers, and this could possibly be something that would propel a car in 2043 or 42?
It was based on real technology. I mean, we had consulted with a JPL engineer named Joe Ryder, and we had talked about the amount of energy actually required to levitate a vehicle. Initially, we were basing the whole concept of the flying car around around semiconductors that are frozen and was able to levitate. But I think they found new ways to do levitation without freezing the semiconductor. So
that's the interesting thing about this project is, like, when we started it back in 2011, this conductor stuff, like, we initially started like, oh, hover cars, let's do it. And then in 2012, that's when the superconductors came out that were frozen that could stick to this track, lock to it, and fly around. Mm-hmm. And then as we were generating the project, we're like, oh, yeah, let's have, like, that froth coming off of the magnets and stuff like that. And by the time we got to the end of the project, they already solved the issue with the freezing, and they didn't need that anymore. They could just run around on the track. And so now that's why you see, like, the magnets don't have the froth and stuff like that coming off of them. So we based it off of as much real technology as possible, but at the end of the day, it's still made up.
Yeah, there's definitely a good deal of fantasy in terms of, like, mm-hmm. how far the magnets are required to be, you know, to actually make the scene that we wanted to make. But at the same time, it can work, just not in exactly the same way that STEMI should. Yeah.
Okay. Any more questions?
Maybe a stupid question. I heard that you studied storytelling, right? Did one of you write the script, actually, or did you hire a professional?
It's a little bit of, like, back and forth. I mean, so the final feature script, I wrote that one, and for this, we actually went through outline together. We just, like, powwowed and went through the ideas, and then... I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, no. I mean, we basically split up tasks, too, as we got towards the end of this whole thing. So Mark and I took up a lot of... Peggy set up the initial VFX pipeline for the project, and once Mark and I started acting on it, Peggy broke away and started writing the script for the project. Mm-hmm. And that itself took a couple of years to do. So she generated multiple ideas for the project and wrote multiple drafts on it while Mark and I were doing multiple ideations and things like that on the post-production.
But we did create the first script ourselves, and we're actually in the process of finding a writer to actually take it even further.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Super impressive.
Hi. Can you guys explain a little bit more of the post-budget breakdown from when you kind of got into Kickstarter? You said, you know, it was a $50,000 overall, but then you've got probably a sliding scale of if you had 3 years into post, but it all came out of your pockets. Kind of, can you kind of break down how you were approaching that if it's just you guys?
Yeah, I mean, like, when we got to the post part, there wasn't a budget for it. So, like, what we did was, like, oh, we spent 6 months, like, here and there, like, oh, yeah, how about we do this or that? And, like, it ended up being, like, whoa, this is not working. We need to find people to really dive in. And once we found the company, they worked with us for a year, and then after a certain time, we figured out the budget for it, and then we had to break it down from there.
They were working on their own side time for the project, just getting things going, and then once they kind of got the overall structure laid out from the models and stuff like that, we built a budget for them and gave them the budget, and then they just ran with all the assets and everything we had built, started comping, started moving forward with it. But it was a lot of prep initially, though. It was a couple of years almost worth of prep, and then the actual final comp happened in, like, 4 months
of
the film.
I mean, the big chunk of, again, like, it took so long because it was all our side time and having to, like, make it work. So it wasn't 3 solid years. It was, like, 3 years of, like, evenings and weekends.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks.
Thank you. Is there any more before we go to the raffle? No? Awesome. Okay. Let's have a big round of applause. Thank you so much.